In this presentation, we are going to look at the background to the recent conflict in which we have three main actors and all are different factions of the Sudan People Liberation Movement, or SPLM. We have SPLM that is the mainstream led by the president, Salva Kiir, and we have the SPLM in opposition led by Riek Machar, who is the vice president, and the SPLM that is led by the former detainees. We'll not really labor into the history so much because we really want to capture the recent events mainly. We will then look at the key elements in the conflict today and review the international response to those elements. And then we have as well to reflect on the African Union, because that is the leading continental body in terms of peace and security. We look at the AU summit that has just concluded in Kigali and how they responded, or rather their reaction to the conflict in South Sudan, and then reflect on the possible way forward in terms of coming out of this conflict. Now, I start by looking at the background briefly at this conflict. And in any given conflict, there are certain elements that are very much at the center of the conflict, or rather the crux of the conflict sits on those particular elements. I would like to highlight just a bit in order for us to link up issues and how they have come to what they are today. We'll recall that in November 2013, President Salva Kiir, who I will be a bit specific in terms of the ethnic groupings as well, so as to bring forth the intricacies of the events and ethnicity within the conflict. So President Salva Kiir is from the Dinka ethnic group. And in November 2013, he dismissed his vice president, Riek Machar, who is from the Nuer group. The two groups are historically the contesting, main contesting groups in South Sudan politics. And that brings in the element of ethno-political differences between the two. We see the ethnic, but now playing out in terms of politics at the national level. And therefore, the basis, or rather the nature of this conflict, is ethno-political in nature. And it sits basically on these two ethnic groups. These ethnic groups have in turn coalesced or rather attracted the other smaller or other ethnic groups within Sudan around them in such a way that the main politics is played linking the two groups. Either you are affiliated to the Nuer led by Riek Machar, or to President Salva Kiir, Salva Kiir's group. Besides that, the president followed on after dismissing the vice president, Riek Machar. He followed on to also undertake a very comprehensive military reform in which he dismissed all the main organs of the ruling SPLM party. And that really also escalated the conflict. There we see the militarization of the conflict. In other words, you extend it into the military arrangements of the country. And by doing that, you definitely touch at the core of the stability of the country, because these are the same individuals who are supposed to guarantee the peace and stability of the country. You disorganize them, and therefore you create enemies. That was the number two of the negative approaches to the conflict. The third aspect was when in December 2013, Riek Machar, in response to what had happened, or people affiliated with him, were accused of having organized a coup attempt against the regime of President Salva Kiir. And that therefore escalated the conflict that had the ethno-political differences at the center of it, having been militarized by the sacking of certain high-level military officers, and therefore the conflict now escalates. At that level, it was still a bit manageable because it was ripe for intervention in whichever case. The tempers had not flared beyond measure. But then what happened will be looked at as we go ahead. We then move into the key elements in the conflict itself. We recall that this is not a new conflict. If you look at the sequence of conflicts in South Sudan, but rather a continuation of many others, going down to the 1990s when Riek Machar deferred with John Garang, and we had the Boer War and all those aspects. Then the same players, Riek Machar, who goes back to the history of the conflict, and at that time Salva Kiir was also within the SPLM, these two individuals have come up to be the main players again in the current conflict. And we see that several attempts have been made, and the latest being the compromise peace agreement for South Sudan, which I call CPAS in this particular discourse, which was signed in May 2015 in Addis Ababa. Riek Machar signed, but then we know very well Salva Kiir did not travel there for reasons that are best known to the core of SPLM that is on his side. But because of the international pressure and persuasion, he ended up accepting to sign, but in Juba, 3 months later, in August. That already shows you that this is not an agreement the two parties were entering completely selfless, that there were hidden interests, that there was reluctance on one or either side of the two. And therefore, at that level, there was a lot of apprehension, even within the international community, amongst analysts, amongst observers, that how will the peace hold when one party signs only 3 months after the other? Now, besides that, that agreement gave hope to the South Sudanese. Why? Because of the elements that it contains. The compromise peace agreement has very strong and focused future for South Sudan. One, because it called for a permanent ceasefire. That's number one. Number two, it calls for the formation of a transitional government. Now, the ceasefire that was called led to the negotiations that have led to the current transitional government that was formed in April this year, when President Riek Machar finally took up his position as the first vice president. Now, that stage of transitional government is where we are today. But then we are seeing the permanent ceasefire, which was the first step, being broken severally, including the recent attacks this month of July between the two factions. Now, it means then the transitional government is also derailed. The third aspect in this peace agreement is that it calls for the formation of a new constitution, which is a fundamental structure within any country. That is the guiding principle in leadership. And finally, and most importantly, it calls for fresh elections, which were to come up. If you look at the structure and the time frame, in 2018, we are supposed to be having fresh elections, in which we expect that the two antagonistic leaders would be replaced by new leadership. But now, when you examine the compromise peace agreement against the time frame, the transitional government is supposed to last for 30 months, in which the new constitution should be in place and new elections be organized based on a new and independent electoral commission. All those things are supposed to happen in just under 3 years. And yet you are still at a level where you are struggling with the ceasefire, not even the transitional government. It therefore calls for real serious commitment if anything is to be realized in these 30 months of the transitional government. We are now talking of a peacekeeping force being sent into South Sudan. That is, does that not again mess up the calendar of events that has been set by the compromise peace agreement? Definitely, yes. Now, besides that, we had also infighting within the SPLM in opposition, led by Riek Machar. Some of his commanders felt that him having signed the compromise peace agreement he had sold the ideals. And therefore, some factions broke up to start fighting both the Riek Machar faction, but also the government faction. So you realize more enemies start coming up even as you try to gear towards peace. Now let's look at the key elements in the conflict further. We realize that in October 2015, Uganda announced that it would pull its troops out of South Sudan. And that was very much in line with the compromise peace agreement and the demands by the Riek Machar's side of the coin, the SPLM in opposition. That was a positive move. Now, if we fast forward to this year, we find that during an extraordinary national convention of the SPLM, which was held in January this year, 2016, and which was attended by Vice President Cyril Ramaphosa of South Africa, South Africa being the mediating country for that purpose, there was an agreement that a transitional government needed to be put in place and that there would be reconciliation between all the factions of the SPLM and that they would have a united force, that's a new army for the country, and therefore it was well received both internally but also internationally. We had the representatives of Tanzania, of the CCM, Chama cha Mapinduzi, the ruling party in Tanzania, who are the co-guarantors of the Arusha Reunification Agreement. The Arusha Reunification Agreement is for the reunification of the SPLA into one force, to bring the SPLA back into what it was, and the SPLM as the movement itself, to back to what it was before this conflict started. Therefore, Tanzania was there as a guarantor of that process, which was agreed on in Arusha. Now, besides that, we had President Festus Mogae of Botswana, who is the chairperson of the Joint Monitoring and Evaluation Commission, which was established under the Compromise Peace Agreement. And therefore, we see all the necessary mediators and persons of high ranking being involved there in that January national convention, in which the parties agreed to the setting up of the transitional government. Now, when we move on, we find that in April, because of the ground set already in January during that national convention, Salva Kiir and Riek Machar, the vice president, agree that now the transitional government can set off and focus now on the further implementation of the compromise peace agreement. But then during that, the first cabinet meeting of the transitional government, this is the statement that President Kiir, part of his discourse, he states that the people who are saying that you cannot be supported with foreign aid unless you form the transitional government of national unity, if they have agents here, they should report back to them that the government has been established. That statement, if you analyze it keenly, is like they are doing it for the sake of showing the international community that for the requirement that you gave us to fulfill for you to release foreign aid has been fulfilled. In other words, we read very little of commitment. If you analyze critical that statement, it's not coming from the need perhaps to have peace, long-term peace, but rather for the international community to be appeased and to release aid. And this goes back to the signing of the compromise peace agreement, in which President Salva Kiir was quite reluctant for a while, for 3 months before he signed. Then you realize that things tend to have been happening because of the international community. And therefore, the genuineness of the peace process in South Sudan remained questionable. Let's now observe the conflict as it has reoccurred this month of July 2016, just a few, maybe hardly 2 weeks before the African Union was to convene in Kigali, 2 days before the commemoration of the fifth or celebration of the fifth independence anniversary for South Sudan, the two groups clash. And when they clashed, it led to, of course, loss of lives, property, displacement, and all those things we have been learning, reading about. And the compromise peace agreement, which was concluded in 2015, as we've seen, was completely disorganized. And that reflects back to what I stated earlier, that the ceasefire agreement, which is the initial process in the whole peace process, gets again distorted. In other words, even the transitional government is now thrown in a limbo. Now, let's look at how the international community reacted to the recent conflict that flared just 2 days before the fifth commemoration of the independence. The United Nations, first of all, it met immediately after the occurrence of that conflict and called on both sides to end fighting and even proposed for more peacekeepers to reinforce the, or rather in addition to the 12,000 UN peacekeepers that are currently in South Sudan. So the UN was quite upfront in what it wanted for South Sudan. Further to that, the UN Security Council called on the president and his vice president to commit themselves to the implementation of the comprehensive peace agreement, which includes the ceasefire, which is very fundamental in the whole process, and the redeployment of military forces from Juba. As we know, both parties have been having their forces in Juba, were sitting across each other and without any smooth relationship. Therefore, the UN called for added peace and if possible, the pulling out of the forces outside Juba because of the likelihood of the collateral damage if they were to continue clashing in a populated place like the city of Juba. Other countries like Britain even proposed an arms embargo on South Sudan within that sitting. US and France condemned the violence as well. And we are talking about the permanent five member states, some of those that voiced their intentions. Now, the IGAD Council of Ministers followed on by meeting in Nairobi the same weekend and reiterating what the UN had already proposed. They called for extra troops into South Sudan. So we see the region adopting the same sentiments that the UN had already voiced, which is very important. There was, for the first time in a long time, consistency in approaches, both at the international level, but also at the regional level. Now, when you come to the national level, the reception of those messages was conflicting, was different. President Salva Kiir was totally, or is still, quite against the deployment of any external forces in what he calls a South Sudanese conflict. But we know very clearly that adversities that this conflict has caused, not only in South Sudan, but even in the region. So by terming it holistically as South Sudanese issue, and therefore we do not need regional implications, or rather involvement by sending extra troops, really created a wave of conflicting messages amongst the IGAD member states. Those that were for the deployment of extra troops and those that may have been reluctant. So you find that the national activities within South Sudan vibrate to the message that the UN has sent, and which coincidentally has been echoed by the IGAD subregion as the main mediating body, the South Sudanese, the government side, being resentful. On the other side, Riek Machar received the involvement of extra troops idea with a positive gesture. Now, on the other hand, Uganda has come up very, very openly to condemn the proposal to impose an arms embargo on South Sudan. President Museveni argues that by imposing an arms embargo to South Sudan, meaning to the conflicting parties, which will be both government and of course, governments have the right to import arms. And therefore, this particular arms embargo was to target the government that you have a blanket slap on the importation of arms. And President Museveni argues that that would weaken the national force, and it would render the national force, SPLA, a puppet to rebels or to non-state actors. And that would further degenerate the conflict into even a worse situation. I don't know what the rest of you think about that argument, but that is what President Museveni holds today. Now, knowing what the region is like, we would want to reflect now on the AU, first of all, before we go back to a few things that we have just as well discussed and wrap up. At the African Union level, the AU summit has just concluded in Kigali. It ran from the 18th of July. And before the AU convened, or I'm sure when they were planning the agenda, South Sudan had not come into focus as it did when the clashes occurred in South Sudan. In other words, it may not have been a top issue as it later became. The main agenda, we all are quite aware, was the election of the new chairperson of the African Union, African Union Commission. Now, the AU's agenda, therefore, was to offer a solution to a crisis that was engulfing Burundi, which has been there for a while. Therefore, that one we really expected. South Sudan had already formed a transitional government, things were looking positive, and therefore even the AU, I think, was having a bit of sleep in terms of, as far as South Sudan was concerned. So Burundi was still quite, and it is still quite an issue, and therefore that was fine. Now, the ongoing fight against Boko Haram was also another issue that was of importance to the African Union at that time. And the violence in Central African Republic, which is now low intensity, and the DRC were also expected things to be discussed. However, now, the resurgence of war in South Sudan complicated the divisions over even who should succeed the current chairperson. I mean, here you have a very fundamental question of electing the new leader of the commission, but just as you deliberate on that, and a conflict breaks out that has been long-standing, but also that requires urgent involvement. Now, definitely, we look back at the process of now what takes primary position. Is it the election of the new chairperson, or is it the sorting out of the new conflict that is causing losses of life? Definitely, the new conflict took precedence, and therefore, besides other elements that were involved in the election of the new chairperson, of course, it did not happen because of the reasons that we know. But in addition to that, I think the whole election process was also interfered with by the new conflict in South Sudan, which needed immediate reaction. And I think whoever will be elected, the new chairperson of the African Union Commission, will have to be somebody that the continent is very sure that is going to stamp his or her authority in terms of ensuring that these conflicts reduce or are solved. Now, let's look at now where the AU finds itself currently. Of the leading candidates in terms of the AU chairperson, which was a very important aspect of the summit, we see that there were three main candidates. We had one from Botswana, we had one from Guinea, and then we had the Ugandan candidate. Now, apparently, the way things went and also the convolution of issues within that time, within the African Union, we find that there was no, countries did not dedicate much time on trying to sort out, or rather to work on to the next chairperson. But then They labored much in terms of solving the conflict, especially the South Sudan one. Burundi was also there. And therefore, these issues were kind of sidelined. But besides that, again, there was also the aspect of who would be the suitable candidate, as we said, who would really run with these conflicts and solve them and help to give proper direction. The vote, therefore, was abandoned, and a rerun is expected in 2017. Now, here you have African, you have South Sudan with its tensions ongoing. We have campaigns for the incoming candidate going on between now and January. In other words, African countries will be divided between who to support as the incoming chairperson, but also how to deal with the conflict on the continent. In other words, the basket has just become fuller, has received more agenda than we thought it would have. If South Sudan did not erupt, and if we had a smooth election, or rather we dealt with this election at this time, the African Union would be today, this morning, viewing things very differently. The African Union's extraordinary summit resolved that soldiers for the continental force, which was proposed by IGAD, and which had been earlier on also proposed by the United Nations, they decided to follow, I would assume, the East African Standby Force model, in which, under the East African Standby Force, the five countries of Uganda, Kenya, Sudan, Rwanda, and Ethiopia were the troop contributing countries, being the core East African Standby Force member states. And therefore, it actually would be argued that there is a logical platform, there is a justification for this force based on the East African Standby Force model. And therefore, it's not really a very strange phenomenon in the region. Okay, it's a rapid reaction kind of force that would stem loss of lives and destruction of property. Now, this would be in addition to the 12,000 plus UN peacekeepers, which were already in South Sudan. But President Salva Kiir bases his rejection on the logic that what will the new force do that the 12,000 UN and strong UN forces have not done? And therefore, he's very categorical. He says that he will not accept even a single soldier. If you go back to President Pierre Nkurunziza's stance when Maprubu, the African Union force that was proposed by the AU, was rejected by Pierre Nkurunziza, his position was that the moment the first soldier sets foot in or lands in Bujumbura, they would be shot. And therefore, the African Union shelved the idea. They never deployed the 5,000 proposed intervention force into Burundi. Therefore, the question is it now this time that the African Union will go ahead and deploy? Of course, whether it is through the East African Standby Force or within the IGAD arrangement, deploy a similar force in South Sudan when it could not do that in Burundi. That remains to be seen. But it is really, at this level, I'm sure, a very troubling issue within the African Union, how to go about doing this. And even if they successfully do it for South Sudan, what will Burundians think? Were we just left that way to go our way? Why didn't they do it for us, first of all? In other words, there's already precedence in failing to do. So when will that be broken? As we conclude, I would want just to give two possible thoughts in terms of how South Sudan, perhaps, in my thinking, could come out of this situation. We see the situation being very complicated, as we've talked. We see it being marred by the toing and reversing of the ceasefire. You see some positives, then they are broken tomorrow. The transitional government is formed. They go back again to the ceasefire issues. You know, when are you going to start negotiating, or rather planning for the new constitution? and eventually organize the election. So we see a lot of those issues. Now, my idea is that the constitutional reforms are the foundations upon which all the country's stability rests. A stable South Sudan therefore calls for a popularly acceptable and democratically endorsed permanent constitution with the pillars for transforming resources into national riches. If you look at the compromise peace agreement, President Salva Kiir and Riek Machar have basically shared the country in terms of leadership based on natural resources. Now, if the conflict resolution is going to be based on who is getting what, then you are going to disenfranchise so many other groups that have no access to leadership. And therefore, that can only be solved if you have very strong constitutional reforms that state what share of the country's values and resources are going to be shared and in which way, so that that is entrenched into some solid constitutional framework. So it will not matter who is in power, but then who is doing what, rather. It would also call for an all-inclusive dialogue, because when you are looking at only two contesting parties to be undertaking dialogue, then you are ignoring so many other players. You are ignoring the civil society. In the context of African conflicts, the religious groups are very important. You are ignoring even the region as such. You are centering yourself on historical enemies, and therefore you are just responding to the task and the vengeance of these two individuals and not looking at the larger South Sudan. And therefore, the over-concentration on the current two SPLM factions will not solve the problem sustainably. It will just be solving them, I mean, bring them to the table to enjoy a few minutes to go back to war the next few minutes. And the 30 months we are talking about will be run over. And 2018, when we are supposed to be having new elections, perhaps may spill into 2025, with the same protagonists playing the same game. And therefore, we need an inclusive dialogue among all forces that addresses major national questions within and outside of SPLM, beyond the Dinka Nuer ethnopolitical divide. So we need to look beyond these two groups. We need to look at the whole country, but it is a mammoth task, both for the African Union, the region, mostly also for the South Sudanese themselves, and the United Nations. We will soon be hearing in terms of what other resolutions the UN may come up with regard to the problem in South Sudan. We are yet to see whether this intervention force is going to be formed, constituted, and how it will land into Juba and what they will do. So we have gone back to a ceasefire, peace enforcement, before you even now take on again the issue of transitional government. As it is today, no one yet knows where Riek Machar could be after the altercations that took place in Juba. And so it takes us back many miles. Thank you all for listening.